accounts and so on, we are around 150 people. And what is, I still find a very impressive number, that even if we have lots of administrative stuff, still over two-thirds of us can configure a Linux kernel, which is quite a nice number at this size of company, I think. So, I will talk about a bit syslog and syslog-ng. How many do you think in this room that logging is cutting trees? I guess outside of the IT world, most of people consider this, but for us, it's recording events on a computer. A typical log message is here, an SSH login. Syslog-ng is an enhanced syslog daemon. Ng is a bit, sounds a bit stupid right now, as it's the oldest syslog still in use, syslog implementation still in use, but at the time it was new generation, as it supported a lot more input and output modes, and it also had a much more flexible configuration language as the original syslog implementation. That's also why it was often referred to as a Swiss Army knife of logging. Before going on with the rest of my talk, I would like to say thank you to Chris, as this presentation wouldn't be possible without being here 2 years ago and listening to his presentation. He was talking about DevOps, and I never heard about this before. And I brought home the message that we should care about this. And 2 years later, the focus of development in syslog-ng is DevOps. It was security earlier, and for quite a long time I had difficulty saying my colleagues that we should focus on also on these kind of guys, but as you will see, it changed quite a lot in the past 2 years. So what syslog-ng can do? Obviously it can send and receive syslog messages. I suppose most of us know the legacy or BSD syslog, as it's still used more than 99% of when logging. There is also a new and more advanced and more standardized IETF standard for logging, but it's not so much widespread. I suppose it's below 1%. The first example message is for syslog as we know, and the second one is an IETF syslog message. It adds more precise timestamping and the support for name value pairs and proper support for Unicode characters and so on. Syslog-ng can do a lot more than simply logging. It can classify logs with parsers. It recently support for JSON formatted messages was added. It can do a lot of things to modify messages. You don't have to think about falsifying, but rather rewriting a message in a form for better suiting the software which analyzes the logs or does anything with it. And the output possibilities in syslog-ng were enhanced quite a lot recently with message queuing and databases like MongoDB, where one can store just about any name value pairs, contrary to SQL databases where it's quite difficult to store arbitrary name value pairs. So I hope everyone knows Babelfish. If you don't, you should read Hitchhiker's Galaxy. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy from Douglas Adams. It's a fish which can translate from just about anything to any language to any other language. Of course, syslog-ng is quite far away from connecting anything with anything, but we are working on it. And recently we heard quite often back from the community that we are becoming a Babelfish. So today I would like to talk about a couple of use cases, how syslog-ng can be used. Before going on, I would like to show a generic syslog-ng configuration, just to better understand the configuration examples later on. It usually starts with with the version of the syslog-ng, as sometimes there are changes, and this way it operates as expected. The next one is not really mandatory, but has some interesting features. It SCL stands for syslog-ng configuration library, and has some configuration snippets and other extensions. Like I will show one of those. Next come some generic global options. And here comes the interesting stuff. Syslog-ng has a pipeline where you define sources, define destinations, define filters and so on, and you chain all of these together with a log statement. So here there is a source with system, with all the system logs and internal logs. One could easily add here a network source as well, combined into a single source. And here is a destination file with everything stored under var log messages. And this log statement is the one which glues all of this together in a this is the one which glues everything together, log statement. And one, of course, extended with additional configuration files. Going back here. So, the first one it is the first use case is how to receive an email about each root login, as you don't really want your admins to log in just and you want to know when an admin logs into a machine. To achieve this, one needs an SMTP server, as syslog-ng itself is not an SMTP server. And of course, syslog-ng. And how does it work? syslog-ng can parse log messages. There are quite a few parsers. I will talk about it in a minute. And in this case, I will use patternDB to parse messages, then filter on the user route, and if there is a match, then send an email through an SMTP server about the event. Before showing the actual configuration, I would like to talk a bit about parsing. Obviously, there are parsers for legacy and IETF syslog, but there are other parsers like CSV parser, which can parse columnar data into fields. In this case, it's a parser for Apache logs. You can see all the fields from an Apache log message. And then a destination. Here is a destination where one of the fields is used in the file name messages, and here you can see that the username is used. So each the logs for each user are logged in a separate file, or if there is no username in the in the log message, then it logged in no user. And here is the log statement gluing all of this together. There are other parsers in syslog-ng. DB parser is the parser, is the name for the patternDB parser. It can parse information from unstructured log messages like the one I've shown at the beginning, the SSH login. For that one needs an XML file describing the log messages, and based on that it can put it can create a name value pairs or classify messages, or even do some correlation. Just a quick show. Here is what it looks like. It's ugly as hell. It's an XML, but at least it works, and it works really efficiently. Unlike regular expressions, where one needs to check each and every message and each and every character needs to be checked, here it's based on a different algorithm. The this is the actual pattern describing the log message, where it's interpreted from left to right. And if there is any, if it doesn't match, it's not checked any further. So one can have thousands of rules without any real performance degradation. Accepted. Here comes a definition for the authentication method. The username and so on, and XML is quite ugly. On the other hand, it makes easy for including test messages, test data, and also adding additional fields, name value pairs based on the log message, or even some tags. So it's easy to, once you know how to write this, it's not that difficult and easy to verify and use. We also have a JSON parser, which also can use the name value pairs defined in the JSON parser. There are also quite a lot of different filters in syslog-ng, and there are Boolean operations, comparisons. It can also check the content of the message, and not only message content, but it can also be narrowed down to the extracted macros and fields. Here is an example. It's from the OpenSUSE syslog-ng configuration, where most of the features are used. It's first a filter on the kernel facility, and then some content based. As it's IP, it's looking for IP table messages. It looks for in and out in the message, and if all of this match, then it can be put into a separate log file. No, let's show the the configuration for the SMTP. It's not a full configuration, but rather the most important part. Here is a reference to the parser. For the pattern DB XML I've shown a few minutes ago. Here is a filter. It matches if the user username is root. Here is SMTP part, and at the end the log statement glues all of this together: the source, the parser, the filter, and the destination. Of course, one can use this just for just about anything. One of my colleagues has a system at home which downloads torrent files based, which can be remote controlled by his mobile phone. And if a torrent is downloaded, syslog-ng reads the logs, and if it's downloaded, then using a very similar configuration, but of course a different pattern DB XML, he parses the successful download and receives an email after each successful download that it's ready. The next one is was a use case by one of our mailing list users. It's logging anonymized JSON messages to MongoDB. It's just put everything together in one thing. Of course, one needs JSON-based log messages. In his case, logs were coming from Node.js, but logs from anything can be used in JSON format can be used. One needs, of course, syslog-ng and MongoDB server. The advantage of MongoDB is that one can store just about any name value pairs in it, which is not possible with traditional SQL databases, or it's possible but not so easily. In this case, JSON parser parses the incoming log messages. Credit card numbers are rewritten by syslog-ng. I will show also that part. Don't ask me what's inside. It looks ugly, and I didn't try that one. And at the end, the anonymized name value pairs are stored in MongoDB. Before going on to configuration, I would like to talk about manipulating messages. There are quite a lot of possibilities. Most often, one doesn't really want to touch the message, but needs in a different format, like just the message part, or in a specific format as a CM wants a slightly different format, and so on. To achieve this, one can use templates and template formats to change the output format of syslog-ng. This is the default format, but one can use one can change it in many ways, in a completely flexible way. And of course, one can also modify message content if necessary, like rewriting parts of the message, which is usually for compliance requirements, as for example, in Germany, one is not allowed to store IP addresses. Of course, not everybody complies, but with syslog-ng it's quite easy. Or in PCI DSS, the credit card numbers are not really allowed to appear outside of the system, and there are some built-in functions to solve this problem with syslog-ng.
Just one question. That means that, for example, in that specific PCI DSS requirement, to apply a filter directly at the source before you write anything on disk or ship the log to a central server?
Yeah, it's possible. And I will show how. First of all, it's in the syslog-ng configuration library, this configuration snippet. It looks ugly, but it works. Here is the regular expression looking for the credit card number. Don't ask me. there are two examples here. One is to replace the credit card number with a hash value, so it's anonymized, but there is something at least, or part of the number is rewritten in the second example. And of course, if you don't like these solutions, you can still find another one. As I mentioned, regular expressions are quite computerly expensive operations. So let's see the example. This is the place where we call it, and in this configuration we only run this replacement on the field which contains the credit card number. So makes the checking much faster. But of course, one can in the original implementation, it checks the whole message. So let's see what this configuration is about. First, we include the credit card masking configuration snippet. Here is a source for JSON messages. It's a TCP port, and it has flex no parse. As by default, every incoming message is treated as a syslog message with the syslog parser, and this is a JSON-based message, so it shouldn't be treated as syslog, as there is no date, there is no host name, there is no program number, program name, just pure JSON. Here is a JSON parser defined, and prefix means here that all name value pairs parsed from the JSON message are prefixed with .json, so later on it's easier to find these name value pairs. So syslog-ng automatically adds the data and the timestamps, the source host and so on as name value pairs. So this way you can make sure that it's easy to find the name value pairs you parsed. The next one is the MongoDB destination, and this example I store only the name value pairs starting with .json, which I used over here. And here is the log statement gluing all of this together. And here we check only the field containing the credit card number, but it's also if we don't give here a value, then the whole message is parsed by default. The next one is sending logs to message queuing, which is a use case often coming from telecommunication companies, where most of the business logic is in based on message queuing. Right now, syslog-ng can send messages to AMQP and STOMP. And coming this summer is 0MQ, which as we have some Google summer of course students, and one of the topic is 0MQ. If he doesn't do this, we will do it anyway, as there were quite a few people expressed interest. And there we don't only want as a destination, but also a source, as it's quite interesting to receive messages from 0MQ. For example, the Fedora infrastructure sends a 0MQ message about everything. Debian is also moving to this kind of operation, and it's interesting to log these messages. This works quite similarly as previous examples, as syslog-ng can use parsers, filters, and so on to find interesting messages, and at the end send those messages to message queuing. Here is just the destination configuration, looking quite similar to previous examples. Here also we use the prefix. Thank you. The last one, which was added quite recently, is supporting real-time statistics with syslog-ng. Obviously, you need syslog-ng, and right now we have Redis and Riemann destination, and working on getting others supported. And here is an example for that. It's working on Apache logs. The source is a access log file. It's the CSV parser which we already seen at the beginning of the presentation, parsing the Apache log file. And here is a Redis destination. As you can see, it's doing a statistics about user agent, how different user agents used in a minutely basis. So it stored increments counters for user agents every minute, and as previously, a log statement glues all of these together. At the end, I would like to talk about the syslog-ng incubator. It's a quite new project. As in syslog-ng, we try to merge only code which is mature, and we don't expect to change it soon. And on the other hand, we also try to develop features quickly if there is an interesting idea in the community what we support, then we try to implement it as soon as possible, and not always in an optimal way. So here comes the syslog-ng incubator, which is a set of modules which are not yet part of syslog-ng, but many of these are used in production already. For example, the Riemann destination, someone was asking about it. We implemented it, and the next few days we learned that more than 100 users started to use it. So, and in production with many machines. Another interesting stuff is Lua destination. One can use Lua script to process log messages, and the Lua interpreter is embedded into syslog-ng, so it's not a separate process, which makes it extremely fast.
Is it just a destination?
Sorry? It's the it's destination. So, you can from Lua you can do anything you want with it. So you can store it. You can send. We have written an Elasticsearch destination in Lua.
Could you use other standard destination?
So you mean process it in Lua and then send back to syslog-ng for further processing? No, it's the end. So you do the filtering and stuff before, and then you send it works as a destination. Do you think that it could be useful to do processing inside Lua and then? I will check it if it's possible when back at home. RSS destination was written just for fun, but people are actually using it, so so you can use your browser to view your last 100 log messages. There is no graphite template, so it's easy to send messages to graphite. And just a few weeks ago, monitoring source was added, which is also based on Lua right now. It's an running Lua scripts in a predefined intervals. So one can source from VM stat or just about doing just about anything to collect data about the running system and send it to graphite or Riemann or to just about anywhere to do system monitoring. The incubator project is quite new, but we already done some packaging, so you don't need to compile it yourself. If you are running Debian, Fedora, OpenSUSE, or Ubuntu, and there is also a port in the FreeBSD port tree for the incubator. Do you have questions?
Well, I'd just like to understand, for example, well, to listen to your arguments to using, for example, syslog-ng and do some kind of filter inside of syslog-ng instead of using, for example, version 1 syslog or R syslog, ship it to something like logstash doing the drop filter itself and using Elasticsearch to store and index the messages.
Why syslog-ng? I just read a blog yesterday but about why syslog-ng and not rsyslog and not logstash. Logstash was dropped out because of performance reasons, and rsyslog was dropped out of the competition because of lack of proper documentation. So the guy was trying to solve his problems with the rsyslog and gave up spending countless hours trying to figure out how things work. He couldn't find it, and syslog-ng has the documentation. Actually, for a couple of years I was working with the documentation team, so I and many people use it because of the configuration language, as you could see. It's quite once you know the logic, of course it takes some time, but once you get used to the logic that source, destination, filter, and so on glued together by the log statement, it's very easy to do it, and very logical, and with rsyslog it's a kind of magic.
Well, I would say that's partially true, but for example, what I did in the past was just using syslog-ng/logshipper, using the EM5 plugin, and reading every log file I wanted without any filter, because the filter was done centrally by logstash in the log filter. So the syslog was just used with the logshipper, and you just manage everything centrally with logstash.
Actually, what I often see is quite similar. Only just a little difference that syslog-ng is in the center, that people leave the different syslog, default syslog on the clients, like rsyslog, and they collect with syslog-ng in the center. They are lazy to change the clients, but when it comes to central logging, then that's more sensitive. Few words about the resources I listed here. The first one is obviously the web page of syslog-ng. I didn't mention also during the presentation, but it's a very interesting project. It's based on syslog-ng. It's a log analysis software based on syslog-ng's pattern DB, and it's quite fast and has many patterns. It's the traditional syslog-ng focus, so it's mainly used by security analysts for firewalls, intrusion detection, and so on, with many built-in features for that. We have a mailing list with just the right amount of emails, so it doesn't flood your mailbox, but if you ask, there is a quick answer on it. My blog and my email if you have any further questions. Okay, thank you.